الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وسندنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين آمنت بالله صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين My dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is indeed a great honor and pleasure for me, firstly, to be in this beautiful country for the first time, and secondly, to be in this august educational institute, Darul Uloom Trinidad, and to meet you in this august forum. And for that, I am grateful after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the institution that has invited me to this country and provided me with such an opportunity to be amongst you and to exchange views and to express and to talk about some aspects of our deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq to act according to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all our walks of life. I am asked to deliver a lecture on any aspect of our deen, Islam, and I have chosen for today's talk a verse of the Holy Quran that I have just recited. Although this verse has a number of subjects that can be addressed with reference to it, yet I intend only to mention one aspect of this verse of the Holy Quran. Let me first translate this verse and then come to the subject I want to draw your attention to. The Holy Quran says in this verse, Huwa alladhi, Allah is the one who has sent among the unlettered people a messenger from amongst them who would recite to them Allah's verses and purifies them and would teach them the book that has been revealed to him, that is the Holy Quran, and teach them the wisdom. While before that, all of them were in clear error. They were straying afar from the right path. This is the translation of the verse. This verse has described the objectives for which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to this world. The basic objectives, the basic terms of reference given to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent him to this world. And these are the objectives about which I intend to say a few words about each of them, because it has a great lesson for all of us and it will throw light on the basic objective that a Muslim institution should have before it and for the Muslims to benefit from that institution. These four objectives that have been mentioned by this holy verse are also referred to in four other places in the Holy Quran. Not only these objectives have not been mentioned in this verse only, rather at four other places Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the same objectives of the advent of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends to give importance to these very objectives. Because of that, he has mentioned these objectives four times in the Holy Quran. The first objective that has been entrusted, the first obligation, first duty, first term of reference given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that he must recite to the people the verses of the Holy Quran. Recitation, tilawa, yatlu alayhim ayati, that he would recite the verses of the Holy Quran to the people. The point that I want to make here is that the recitation of the Holy Quran has been mentioned by this holy verse as distinct from teaching the book. Because in the next objective it is mentioned, يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches them the book. It means that he teaches the meaning of the book, teaches the basic teachings of the book. So these teaching of the book, that teaching of the meaning of the book, has been mentioned separately and distinctly from recitation of the Holy Quran. So it means that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had two different objectives before him. One is to recite the verses of the Holy Quran. It means that he recites the verses of the Holy Quran so that he may teach the people how to recite it, regardless of whether they understand it or not. And then the second objective is to teach the book, teach the meaning of the book, convey to them the message of the book. These two objectives are totally separate and different and distinct from each other. The point here is that it indicates that the recitation of the Holy Quran itself is an objective and is an act of worship and carries much sawab. And this refutes those who sometimes say that if a person recites the Holy Quran without understanding its meaning, they say that it is useless. And when in these madrasas, the pupils, the children are made to do hifz of Holy Quran, that commit the Holy Quran to their memory, sometimes they argue that it is useless because it carries no sense that a child having no meaning of the Holy Quran at all, not understanding the meaning of the Holy Quran, is compelled to memorize the Holy Quran and commit it to his memory. What is the benefit he is achieving from that exercise? And it is useless that the words of the Holy Quran are repeated like puppet and without understanding. There are some persons who object on the recitation of the Holy Quran in this way. So this verse indicates that recitation of the Holy Quran in itself is an objective of the advent of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not only explain the meaning of the Holy Quran, he has also taught the Sahaba how to recite it. The way of recitation of the Holy Quran has been taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhu ajma'in. And it is mentioned at another place in the Holy Quran, لا تحرك به لسانك لتعجل به إن علينا جمعه وقرآنه فإذا قرأناه فاتبع قرآنه. When Rasulullah received the revelation from Jibreel alayhi salam, he felt much of stress on his heart. Sometimes he used to sweat out of the stress he felt during the revelation. And at the same time, he used to repeat the verse revealed to him by the Jibreel alayhi salam. And it doubled and multiplied the stress Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa felt at that point of time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no, la tuharrik bihi lisanaka lita'jala bihi. You need not repeating the verse. And having such a stress upon you. Because inna alayna jam'ahu wa qur'ana. If you are anxious that you may forget the verse, no, you will not forget, because it is our duty. It is our responsibility, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is our responsibility that we will make this Quran memorized by you in your heart. In anna alayna jam'ahu wa qur'ana. Then it is also on us, it is also our responsibility to teach you how to read it. فَإِذَا قَرَأَنَاهُ فَاتَّبِعْ قُرْآنَ. Then when we recite it through Jibreel to you, then you must follow that way of recitation that Jibreel has brought to you. So Jibreel taught the Rasulullah how to recite the Quran, and Rasulullah taught the people, the Sahaba, how to recite it. And through this education, an unparalleled science has been developed by the Muslims that has no parallel, no example in any other language, in any other religion. That is Ilmut Tajweed. Ilmut Tajweed gives you the education how to recite the Holy Quran. It is a very delicate science that has described how to pronounce a letter. For example, if you want to pronounce ha, so what is the source of pronunciation of ha? And what is the difference between ha and ha? Seen and saad and sa. So this science has been developed by the Muslims in order to comply with the objective for which Rasulullah has been sent. So they developed the ilm al-tajweed, in which every letter that is used in Arabic, every letter is explained how to be pronounced and from which part of your mouth or of your throat it comes out. You will never find such a science in any other language, in any other religion. For example, English, you know, is believed to be the most, very vast language, a universal language, international language. But can you find somewhere how to pronounce D, and how to pronounce T, and how to pronounce C, or B, or L, or M, or N? There is no such science. And that is why everybody pronounces it as he wishes. So there is no such science found in any language. It is only for the sake of the Holy Quran that the ulama, scholars, have developed this science, and huge books are written on that subject. And this is one of the subjects that is taught in our madaris, in our education institution. So the notion that merely pronouncing the Holy Quran, the recitation of the Quran, has no merit, or there is no sense to recite it without understanding it, this notion is quite wrong and totally untrue. And this verse is one of the basic reasons that has been mentioned by the Holy Quran as a distinct objective of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this gives us an instruction that every one of us who claims to be a Muslim, he must learn the correct pronunciation of the Holy Quran, the correct recitation of the Holy Quran, without which his recitation may be wrong. Because sometimes sometimes if you pronounce a verse of the Holy Quran wrongly, it totally converts the meaning. It totally changes the meaning, alters the meaning wrongfully. Therefore, every Muslim is duty bound to learn how to recite the Holy Quran correctly. And it is not very difficult for a common people. You know, although the ilm al-tajweed is a great science, as I told earlier, but, if a common man, a layman, wants to learn this science only for the purpose of reciting the Holy Quran correctly, and making his salah, making his prayer acceptable, then it is not very difficult. Why? Because the Arabic language has only 29 letters, not more than 29 letters. And every letter has a particular way to be pronounced. So if you learn only one letter a day from a competent teacher, then it will take you only 29 days to learn how to pronounce the Arabic words and how to recite the Holy Quran. Not more than 29 days, if you are learning it from a competent teacher. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that when one recites the Holy Quran, then at the time of recitation of every single letter, you will credit 10 virtues to your account of Akhirah. You know, if you, and he has also explained that if you pronounce Alif Lam Meem, then Alif is one letter, Lam is one letter, Meem is one letter. So by merely reciting Alif Lam Meem, you have secured 30 virtues to your credit in the Akhirah. So this is so much meritorious act that one should not leave his home before reciting some parts of the Holy Quran. This is one of the lessons that we gather from this verse that I have just recited. Because this is one of the objectives of the Holy Rasul, of the Holy Prophet for which he was sent to this world. The next purpose or objective for which Rasulullah has been mentioned to have been sent to this world is that he yu'allimuhumul kitab. He was sent to this world because he was supposed to teach all the people the divine book, that is the Holy Quran, which has been received to him. So after reciting the holy verses, he was supposed and he was interested to teach the meaning and explain the precepts of the holy book, that is the Holy Quran. Yu'allimuhumul kitab. The point that I want to make here is that yu'allimuhum, the Quran says, the Holy Quran, yu'allimuhum, the Holy Prophet teaches them the book. Them means Sahaba, Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, Usman, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and all the Sahaba. So the point to consider here is, what is the meaning of teaching the Holy Quran to these people? Is it only the translation of the Holy Quran that they needed? Obviously no, because each one of them was Arabic speaking. Not only Arabic speaking, but if each one of them had was very eloquent and fluent in Arabic language, every one of them, you know, knew what is the correct meaning or association of a particular word used by the Holy Quran. So in order to understand the Holy Quran, they did not need any translation. So it proves that the teaching of the Holy Prophet ﷺ to these Sahaba, it is not meant to give them the translation. Rather, it embedded some other thing than merely translation. So it indicates that the Holy Quran cannot be properly understood only on the basis of translation. Had it been so, Sahaba would not need the teaching of the Holy Prophet. So, some people in our society, they say that the translations of the Holy Quran are available with us, and we can read those translations, and then we on ourselves infer and deduct the precepts of Sharia from the Holy Quran without having any recourse to any teacher or any instructor or any tafsir or any book of the commentary of the Holy Quran, because the translation is with us. But this verse indicates that this approach is totally wrong, erroneous, because if the translation had been enough, then there was no need for the teaching of the Holy Prophet ﷺ to Sahaba Abu Bakr Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhum, ajma'in. And this is a very important point, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever He revealed a book, a divine book, for the guidance of mankind, He always sent a messenger with it. There are examples where messengers came to this world, but no new divine book was revealed. Many messengers, many prophets came without a new book. But there is not a single example where the book has been revealed and messenger did not come. Whenever a book was revealed, a messenger came with it. Torah was revealed on Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. He brought the Torah to the people. Injil was revealed to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. He brought Injil to the people. Zabur was revealed to Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam. He brought it to the people and explained it. Why? Because it is the nature of human beings that in order to learn something, a book is not sufficient for a human being. Human being needs a teacher, an instructor, who could teach him how to act upon it. You know, for example, there are many books printed, published, on medical science. If someone picks up the books and reads them on his own and claims that I understood the medical science and opens a clinic to treat the patient, will it be allowed to do so? No one would allow a person merely on the basis of his self-study to play with the lives of the people, unless he takes a full training, you know, from a reliable, competent doctor. Not only that, but he will also pass through a period in which he, house job in the hospitals. You know, practical experience. Without it, he will not be allowed to act as a doctor. So medical science cannot be learnt only on the basis of the book. So much so, there are many cookbooks that tell you how to cook the meals. Okay? But if someone takes the book and cooks the meal according to the instructions given by that book, I don't know what will he make. You know, he cannot make a proper food only on the basis of cookbook. So if a person cannot, learn this only out of the book, unless he has a teacher, unless he has an instructor, how can a religious guidance can be achieved only on the basis of the book? That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send any single book without a messenger. And the messenger was sent, يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. He will teach how to understand the book, how to act upon it. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. And that is exactly what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has done to Sahaba. Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that I learnt Suratul Baqarah from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in 8 years. In 8 years. And he says, فَتَعَلَّمْنَا الْعِلْمَ وَالْعَمَلَ وَالْقُرْآنَ جَمِيعًا. It took us 8 years because we learned how to recite the Holy Quran firstly, and how to act upon it, and how to explain it. Everything, you know, we learned from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It took us 8 years in Surah Baqarah only. So these were Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in who, you know, received the meanings of the Holy Quran. And let me clarify another point to you. Sometimes people say that the Holy Quran itself says that it is easy for the people. لَقَدْ يَسَّنَّ الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. We have made the Quran easy. But they forget that the Holy Quran itself says we have made the Quran easy for taking lesson. For, taking lesson, for taking advice, not for inferring or deducting the laws and legal orders of the Holy Quran. You know, if you read the Holy Quran for the purpose of that it may remind you of the Akhirah, of the Jannah, of Jahannam, of, you know, and he prompts you to do pious acts. It is all easy. There is no problem. You can do it with the help of a translation. But if you want to say this is halal and this is haram, and you, on the basis of translation, you claim that I understood the Holy Quran for the first time, and all the 1400 scholars were wrong in interpreting this verse, and to claim ijtihad for you, then it is not acceptable at all, because it is the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who teaches the correct meaning and correct precepts of the Holy Quran and no other. The third objective for which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent, as mentioned by this verse, is wal hikmah. Yu'allimuhumul hikmah, which means that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sent to this world in order to explain to them what is wisdom. What is wisdom? So wisdom is also taught by Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This gives us another very important point. The point is that if the Holy Quran says that it is the Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that will teach you what is wisdom, it means that you cannot decide wisdom only on the basis of your own rational arguments. It is not pure reason that decides what is wisdom, what is not wisdom. It is the criteria for being, for something being wise, or criteria for identifying wisdom in a particular act. You must turn to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You must, have lesson from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, without which your reason may misguide you. Today, many people say that we will act upon our own reason. Our reason is the basic criteria for all of our acts, all of our beliefs. But these poor people do not understand what reason is. Reason, if it is detached from the prophetic revelation, if it is isolated from divine guidance, then it is not reason at all. It is a, in fact, in the terminology of the Holy Quran, it is hawa, ahwa. وَلَوْ اتَّبَعَ الْحَقُّ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ لَفَسَدَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. So why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when sent us to this universe, we needed knowledge for living on this planet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided us with some sources of knowledge. Eyes to see, ears to hear, nose to smell, tongue to taste, and the hands and feet to touch, and to feel. By these sources we acquire knowledge. But these sources are not enough to give us every kind of knowledge. There comes a place where these sources do not work. At that point of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us another source of knowledge, that is reason. By reason, we can know what we could not know through our own, senses. You know, but as the senses, as the function of senses was not limitless, it has some, its own limits. Likewise, reason has its own limits. And there are places where reason does not work properly. At that point of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a third source of knowledge, that is revelation, that is given to us by the prophets. So revelation comes where reason stops. So therefore, if a particular precept, a particular description, or particular order, or prohibition seems to be against reason, and that cannot be repudiated, it cannot be cannot be denied, only because my reason does not accept it, because revelation comes where reason does not work. For example, if you see all the philosophers, right from Aristotle up to Bertrand Russell or any further philosophers, all of them claim to use their own reason. You know, socialists claim to use their reason for determining what is wrong, what is right, what is wrong. Capitalists, you know, every philosophy, every system of life claims that it acts on reason. But there are differences, you know, they are conflicting with each other, because they are devoid of the divine guidance. There was in our history, there was a sect that was called Karamata or Batiniya. One of their leaders has written a detailed letter to his followers, in which he says that it is stupidity that someone gives his sister to another one in marriage, while his sister was very beautiful and very cooperative with him, but he gives his sister to another person and brings a totally alien woman from outside that is not so beautiful nor so cooperative with him, and you know, he spends his own wealth to the others and brings someone that is not helpful to him. Has it been a wise person, he could have retained his own sister in his home, at his home. This is what his reason, you know, leading to his reason. But because this reason is devoid of divine guidance at all. You know, even today, if you open Encyclopedia Britannica, and the article on atomic bomb, you know, the first sentence that you will find in introduction of atomic bomb is that this is the bomb through which the life of 1 million people was saved in Nagasaki and in Hiroshima. The lives of 1 million people not destroyed. Life of 1 million people was saved through this atomic bomb. The argument is that had it not been dropped, then the American soldiers in the number of 1 million would have been killed in this war. But since this war dropped, the lives of 1 million people has been saved. So they do not describe the destructive effects of atomic bomb. They are arguing in favor of atomic bomb because it has saved the lives of 1 million people. So this is the rational arguments. You know, so if you detach reason from divine guidance, it gives you such answers. So therefore, what Rasulullah says is the wisdom. Even though your reason is not, accepting it, for example. But if Rasulullah has decided that this is the reason, you must accept it. Because it is the wisdom that has been determined by Rasulullah يُعَلِّمُهُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. He will teach you what is wisdom. If we, when we say, for example, that interest is haram, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared war against those who are involved in interest. The people say, why? Why interest is haram? Doesn't seem any wrong with it. It is a transaction like a sale is a transaction. There is no difference between the two. So we will not accept it unless our reason accepts the basic cause for which it has been prohibited. But the same argument was advanced by the people of Jahiliyyah. إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ مِثْلُ الرِّبَى. They said, sale is like riba. There is no difference between the two. Both should be permissible. Both should be allowed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have explained the reason of the prohibition of riba, but he avoided it. He said, no, أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed sale, but he has prohibited riba. You must accept it, even though your reason does not catch the basic cause of prohibition. You must accept it wholeheartedly. So this is the meaning of Islam, to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to submit to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's guidance in totally. So this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent for, to explain what is the wisdom. So those who search for wisdom behind any precept, every precept of the Sharia, should know that sometimes there are many occasions in which we cannot properly understand the wisdom of a particular rule. There is wisdom behind every rule of Sharia, but it is not necessary that we understand it properly. So therefore, one should not say that unless I appreciate the basic wisdom behind an order of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I would not accept it. This is not a behavior of a true Muslim. He must submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, submit to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The fourth thing, the fourth objective that has been mentioned by this holy verse is yuzakkihim, that he purifies the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained these four things. Rasulullah has recited the Holy Quran to Sahaba, but it is not enough. He was interested to teach them the book, that is the meaning of the book. This is not enough. He was also interested to teach them the wisdom, but still it is not enough. The fourth function or fourth objective is mentioned as tazkiyah, that is purifying them. What does it mean? Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum learned the Holy Quran, learned its meaning, learned its wisdom, everything. Still they needed something more, that is tazkiyah, that purify them, which means that a person sometimes is spoiled of some inner instincts, that, you know, lead him astray. For example, someone develops, you know, jealousy. Jealousy is a disease of heart. So Rasulullah was supposed to remove this and purify Sahaba from this. Likewise, arrogance is a disease that is developed in one's heart. Even though a person is a proper, knowledgeable person, he has good knowledge, he is a scholar, he has achieved, has got degrees from reputable institutes, but he might have developed this arrogance. This is disease that has developed in his heart, so he must be purified of it. So jealousy, arrogance, show off, these are diseases that are developed in one's heart. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to train the Sahaba to purify them of all such diseases. Those who were, you know, under, those who had no control over their anger at all. They used to fight with each other for years and years. You know the war of Basus in the days of Jahiliyyah was fought only because one person has killed the chicken of the other. You know, both started, you know, altercating, and then their family came out and their tribe came out and swords came out and started a war that continued for 40 years. No, they were so, you know, so overpowered by their anger, by their, you know, bad instincts. But when Rasulullah came to this world and he purified them, now the same people controlled their anger, and they did not move a step unless there is a permit from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and from Sharia. You know, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, was a person, very hard person. But when he embraced Islam, a poor old woman would catch his hand and took him with her and advised him and even reproached him, and he listened quietly. So this change in their hearts, in their instincts, in their behavior, in their attitude was brought by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam through this function of tazkiyah, yuzakkihim. And it indicates that even after having knowledge of Sharia or knowledge of Islam, one has to pass through a procedure in which he is purified from these diseases. And this is actually what the ihsan means. Ihsan, tazkiyah, suluk, sometimes it is called tasawwuf. Although when we use the word tasawwuf, many bad things have crept into it and therefore have spoiled it. But the correct and exact sense of tasawwuf is this, that every person should be purified from his inner diseases. And this is also done by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sahaba was purified. Sahaba did the same thing to their pupils, Tabi'in. They were purified. And this is the chain that is coming to us right from the days of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, my brothers and sisters, I'm sorry for taking such a long time of your precious time, but I wanted to indicate that these are the basic objectives for which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent. And if you see the madaris, this Darul Uloom, for example, or any other Darul Uloom. In fact, they are working for these four objectives. They have Hifz class or Quran class in which recitation is taught, how to recite the Holy Quran. They have, you know, Islamic Sharia classes in which they teach the Kitab, the Quran, how to, what is the meaning of the Quran, and what are the precepts of the Holy Quran through Hadith and Tafsir and Fiqh, and what is the wisdom. This is also taught within the Fiqh books and, you know, Asrar books, etc. And it is tried that an atmosphere in these education institutions is created that may help one to purify himself from these bad instincts that he has in his heart sometimes. So this is the basic objective of a madrasa or a religious institute, and we should try to take as much benefit of these institutions as we can, and also to design our lives in a way that these objectives are fully met. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to act upon the Holy Quran and the instructions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And at the end, I express my gratitude again to the people of this Darul Uloom who have achieved this goal by establishing this Darul Uloom, and they have done a remarkable achievement by establishing such institute in this part of the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. May Allah ta'ala grant them success and accept all these efforts. Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala huwa al-muwaffiq wal-mu'in wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alamin.